Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, greetings to you on this Mother's Day 2020. I would like to briefly share with you on the title Mother's Legacy. I want to take us back to the ministries of Paul the Apostle during his missionary travels. On his second missionary travel to Lystra in Acts chapter 16, we find that he comes across a young man by the name of Timothy, who was then about 33 years old. And Paul was very much impressed with this young man, and especially when he heard good reports about him, about his faith and commitment. Only soon would he realize that this man was of a Greek lineage. His father was a Greek, but his mother was Jewish. And he also found out that his grandmother, Lois, and his mother, Eunice, had played a very significant role in bringing him to Christ and also helping him to grow in his faith. He immediately took a liking to him and invited him to join in his ministry. And so thick was their friendship and partnership. He was like a spiritual child to Paul. Writing to the Philippians in Philippians chapter 2 verse 20, he told them that there's no one like Timothy. He even is supposed to have co-authored 6 of the 13 books that Paul wrote to the early Christians. It is said that Timothy became the first Christian bishop of the city of Ephesus, but he died tragically as a martyr at the age of 80 when he was sharing the gospel to the worshippers of Diana. We find Paul also mentioning about the legacy of faith that Timothy has inherited from his mother and grandmother. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 14 and 15, he talked about him learning about the faith and scriptures while he was yet young, and how he had now become such a faithful worker. As we can see here, mothers and grandmothers do have a great influence and can play a great role in shaping and forming children. Not only the children, but through them, churches, nations, and generations to come. So it is true, as William Wallace would write in his poem, "The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world." Such is the importance of mothers. In today's world, we find that many people, especially women, who are career-oriented, may sometimes put career before family, before marriage, before motherhood. And even if they are married, they would not have time for the family or for the children. I say this out of concern, and not to mean that all the working women are like that. I think many of them are dedicated mothers, and for that we praise God. But motherhood is something that we cannot contract out, we cannot outsource to others. Being a mother is a very noble thing. So I hope that we will have more and more career women who would also be excellent mothers as well. The Bible gives a lot of importance on motherhood. In the Old Testament alone, there are 232 mentions of mother. And in the New Testament, 96 mentions are made. 84 mothers are named in the Old Testament. Our excuse as mothers can never be that they are not educated enough to rear a child. I don't think that is the case. We all have sufficient knowledge, God-given, about what is good and bad. What is hard work? What is respect? What is cleanliness? What is faith? What is prayer? What is the Bible? We can read the Bible. Most of us today are literate. Or even if you have difficulty with that, you can even take your children to Sunday school and introduce them to a good environment. We can also teach how we can be loving, kind, and forgiving and patient through our life role modeling. All of this is education. So we can never say that we are uneducated, unqualified. It is so important, motherhood. So we must never say, I would not encourage mothers to say, when they are asked what they do, that they are just a mother. Motherhood is everything in many ways. So you should be proud that you are a mother. You should be proud that you are a homemaker. Psychologists say, and education is, that children till the age of seven are the most impressionable. That is the time when they learn the most. And they will never forget what they learn. Aristotle, the great philosopher, said, "Give me a child until he is seven, and I will show you the man." He is challenging people to say that I can make a person what they should be if you would only bring them to me for that particular number of years. King Solomon, in Proverbs 22, verse 6, says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." So let us take children seriously, be it your children or even others brought to your sphere of influence. Enjoy time with them, play with them, but also have moments of teaching, learning with them as well. I know that most of our women, especially mothers, are almost superwomen. And we must be so grateful to our mothers on this Mother's Day. They manage the kitchen, they manage the home so well, multitasking. They would be taking care of everything at home, including the children, the husband, and so much that they do. We must be grateful. I know that this is true in all our homes, especially these days when children are under a lot of academic pressure. The mothers become indispensable. The Bible talks about many heroes of faith, and mothers are definitely mentioned amongst them. We see that God's covenant with his people, especially if you look at Abraham, is to do with the promise of blessing with children. He says your inheritance, your generations would be so much more than the numbers of sands on the beach or the stars in the sky. So the people of those days were concerned about their future, their legacy, and their generation, continuance of their line, as it were. But we see that God wanted the people to go beyond that, to give them a sense of destiny, to let them know that they are chosen by God, not just to fill up the earth, not just to increase in numbers, but to be a blessing, to be the representatives of God. And so we see that being played out in the lives of his children. If you see God's conversation with Abraham, he says, I will bless you and I will make you a blessing. I will make you into a great nation, and through you, many nations, other nations will also be blessed. That is always the principle of God working when he blesses us as his people. The legacy that we see in the Old Testament of a faithful woman, whether it be Sarah or Hannah or Rebecca or Rachel, we see all this line of faithful women. If we see Sarah and see how God had blessed her at the age of 90 with a son called Isaac, we look at the life of Isaac and see the faithfulness of this young man. When he was about 25 or so years old, God tested Abraham further and said, you go and kill your son, your only son, and offer him as a sacrifice to me. Isaac went along with his father, and he was carrying the wood that would be used to burn him after he was killed as a sacrifice. Even when his father, old father, was tying him up and placing him on the wood, he did not rebel. He did not question. He could have overpowered his father and run away. He did not. Such was the nature of this faithful, noble young man. He was obedient. He was patient. He had faith in God. All of that qualities that you find. So, what a blessing it was to have such a man. And we see that Timothy was blessed to have this mother and grandmother. The instructions that they gave gained so much more significance when we consider that the world that they lived in, as Paul will write in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to 5, was the last days. Significantly, even we also live in the last days. He lists about 19 sinful characteristics of those days. Lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, all of this. They needed special instructions those days to be guarded from all of that. And God used his mother and grandmother to instruct him, to make him into what he became. And so, mothers are so important. It is my prayer that all of you who consider yourself to be mothers, or who one day will become mothers, will take this as a mission and be faithful to the Lord, so that God will use you to establish Christian homes that will honor the Lord. God bless you. Amen.